演讲题目是 Number Three， 计时开始。
When Taiwanese people thought of Southeast Asia, the first thing come to our mind is the workers from there, the people from Philippines, Thailand, and Indonesia. They also work for homes and teachers. Taiwanese also thought that they are not our native. So this time, I want to discuss more about this problem. Our next speaker, Yu Zhen, will continue our speech.
Thank you, Zhao Yu. I have an English teacher who is from Philippines. I like him so much. We enjoy his classes because he usually talks about his cultures, his country's cultures and tradition. And he talks about his family and he usually talks funny stories with us. I think it's very interesting. He has a half Philippines and half Taiwanese daughter. I asked him how he met his wife. He told us they studied in the same university in Australia. What's more, it's totally not a problem that they are from different countries. Our next speaker, Feng Hao, will elaborate on the detail of this topic.
Well, according to my experience, we normally don't understand them. That's why we always have a misunderstood about their culture, their everything. I've been to Malaysia, and we always have a thought that Malaysians have a really high discrimination of Chinese. Either it's from mainland or Taiwan, or it's originally just from Malaysia. They all have a kind of discrimination. And we all follow that, like, people who believe in Islamic are really aggressive. They can be very aggressive about using Allah as for their reason why they wanted to break the law. But I've been to Malaysia, and I think about how Malaysians are not as how we think about them. I've been to a train station, and then he was like, I was lost. And then I asked a Malaysian. He said he didn't say that's not my business, or he didn't say because you're he didn't reply me with Chinese like, oh, it's not my business, and so I'm not going to do that. Instead of that, he actually said, oh, sir, you have to go all the way back to the monorail area, and then you have to take, and then you can take the train. So this changed my mind. I always felt like. And in the books, in every internet, people's like, oh, when you enter the custom, Malaysian will start like, oh, you Chinese, this is not a real passport. No, it's not always like that. There are always good people and bad people in different countries. Of course, for people who always think about, after 9/11 especially, people always think about, oh, Arabians, they have a strong influence about, you know, breaking the law. But this is all because of our misunderstood. Not all everybody are like that. I actually met Arabian friends, and they were like, they believe like they don't think what everything they do must be breaking the law. No, not of course not like that. But based on my truth, on my experience, they were all like. Malaysians, we all have a misunderstanding about every people, different culture, different race, and that's a big problem of Taiwan. They don't understand them. I think before knowing these people, we should put down our discrimination of them, so then we can bring a more peaceful, more better world. Our next speaker, Xiang Wen, will share another example for you.
Thank you, Zhao Yu. Now the example I would like to share you was the experience in Bali. The first in commander to this small island was when I was an 11th child. The first observations, I think they are very enthusiastic. because when they arrive at the hotels, they will give each of us a wreath, and at the same time, the performer will play the music for us. The most remarkable for me is their always wearing smile when they are playing music. But another observation is they have a tradition of immediate tip. But I think it won't affect my interest in visit Bali because I know every country has their own tradition. If I have a chance, I would like to visit to Southeast Asian country again. Thank you very much.
Number 5, 计时开始。
Good morning, dear judges and fellow students. Globalization is a process of interaction and integration among the people, companies, and governments of different nations. A process driven by international trade and investment, aided by information technology. It is affecting every nation, every level of industry, and virtually every individual. Globalization enables companies and individuals to establish relationships anywhere in the world. It also increases people's freedom to shape their identities and sharpen their talents. Allows consumers to buy the best the world has to offer, and producers to find partners and buyers worldwide. This dynamic process empowers individuals and companies to make new wealth in ways undreamed of just a few years ago. However, it's also forcing difficult changes. In terms of economy, for example, management become increasingly complex, confronted with the need to maintain the confidence of markets, both domestic and international. Successful integration of countries in the global economy will increasingly distinguish strong from weak economic performances. All in all, these tough challenges can be narrowed down to one word, competition, very keen competition. How to stay competitive? To exploit a greater upside while minimizing the lesser downside. The key to success, we believe, lies in the ability to adapt. To adapt more easily, we need to be endowed with knowledge, skills, values, and the capabilities needed in order to survive, to contribute, and to benefit from globalization. First of all, we need to enhance our mobility. The ability to move around the world, the ability to work and live in any part of the world. In addition to a good command of foreign languages, we need to have a good understanding of local culture and embrace the cultural differences with respect. After all, effective interaction and integration only come from mutual understanding and respect. Secondly, engage ourselves in the most pressing affairs at home and in the world, understanding their global context and the connections between the local and the global. Anything that happens in the world, like Ebola virus or refugee problems facing Europe, will definitely affect us in no time. Only by having a clearer picture of the world around us can we best deal with changes and challenges.
Furthermore, we should take full advantage of what we're excellent at. Taiwan is noted for computer engineering, information science, innovative designs, precision industries, biotechnology, and so on. Though lacking natural resources, Taiwan has the best talents in the world. We should be devoted to researching and developing, making Taiwan an irreplaceable and respectable competitor and partner. To be well prepared and stay competitive in the globalization system, people are demanded to learn new skills, far more complex ones than they're used to. Here, education plays a very crucial role. In fact, the large difference in opportunities in education between countries is one of the basic causes of global inequality. Luckily, in Taiwan, we have very effective education systems to help. Through lifelong learning, we can continually improve our job skills, add greater value, and increase our productivity. As long as we strive hard and keep learning, we will be able to create a brand new era of prosperity, and the odds will be ever in our favor. Thank you.
演讲题目是 Number Two， 计时开始。
We are living in a world where the information had exploded. But what kind of information are we receiving every single day? We all take Facebook or Instagram as a major way to access the information. But that is not what we really need. Those information which is simply to get or sometimes showed up automatically are not giving us anything. What if we want to know more about other countries or even talk to the foreigners? Yes, Facebook might offer some assistance, but there must be a much better way to communicate with them and know more about them. Those methods divided into two aspects, governmental and non-governmental. Believe it or not, governmental is a much more convenient way. If you want to experience the culture yourself, overseas study or international education visit is the two best options. Furthermore, the development of internet can furnish you some help either.
Thanks, Kefi. Each youth can be a future power of Global Village. So our government has spared no effort to provide resources for all of us to access the world. Now, with the internet, those resources can be seen online. And one of them is called iYouth. Its central idea is to make our international dreams come true, containing a meaning of international, information, and interaction. It not merely gives us a chance to understand the world better, but also gives us an opportunity to try something new, such as international efforts, study abroad programs, or volunteer opportunities. And the best part of this website is that we can see some other users share their experience on it. Whether it's about their accomplishment or international exchange, it can all enhance youth interaction. Now, next, Vanessa will continue for us.
Thank you, Chuck. What's more, non-governmental methods also play crucial roles in international communication. For instance, Postcrossing is a website which gives its members an interesting way to interflow with others. Members can get addresses from website, and it could be Holland, Germany, or even China. Members will also get postcards from different countries, and they will never know which postcard they are receiving until getting it. On the postcards, members can write tons of things, such as introductions of their culture, traditional activities, and festivals. Can you imagine that a daily action like sending a postcard can bring us virtual diplomacy? All you need is a stamp, a postcard, and a bit of enthusiasm. Next, Penny will sum up for you.
Thank you, Vanessa. All in all, with a variety of opportunities that provided by governmental or non-governmental organizations, we can seize the chance we want anytime. However, they won't just show up spontaneously. We need to be more cautious and aware that we are the country of 100. Thus, we should be humble and knowing that the way to stay in competitiveness is to increase our knowledge and experiences in this expanding world. Therefore, absorbing more experience and information can help us with that. All in all, though globalization indeed brings the impact to us, there's no need to be panic or sorrow, as long as we keep on trying and taking the advantages of those methods. We believe that we can conquer all the difficulties and spread the best side of Taiwan toward the world.
Youth can make the world different as long as we try. Distance will no more be obstacle.
Stepping out of limit zone
and you can make it.
Thank you and have a nice day.
Honorable judges, good morning. The modern world is a global village. With the advances in information technology and transportation, as well as free trade, globalization transcends geographic borders. A change in one part of the world affects the rest of it. In 1999, after the 921 earthquake, Taiwan's silicon wafer production and shipment concerned the world. The Lehman Brothers bankruptcy in America set up the worldwide financial crisis in 2008. In the same year, the Tandik mill in China caused its people to raid the neighboring countries for supplies. Not only were the mill products in this country in short supply, but the price soared. In 2011, after the earthquake and tsunami struck Japan and wrecked the Fukushima nuclear power plant, the interruption of power supply not only damaged the local industry, but affected the production of cars and electronics in Western countries.
Globalization has created such interdependence between countries that it presents the world with opportunities and challenges in many aspects. In terms of economy, free trade has brought the circulation of goods, personnel, technologies, and funds among countries, which in turn accelerates globalization as well. In other words, the market has expanded, which means more competitors from around the world. To survive the cutthroat competition, some companies go through business transformation to provide better service and products. Others struggling with cost down move factories overseas, say to Southeast Asia, to acquire cheaper labor and land. Still others may end up closing down.
Politically speaking, more and more nations look to regional integration to achieve broader social political objectives through agreements or unions, such as the European Union and the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Culturally speaking, the mass media virtually speed up the process of introducing foreign cultures. On one hand, hybridity is born of cultural fusion. On the other hand, this process of fusion may result in traditional cultures disappearing. While the individuals enjoy these advantages, they are in fact vulnerable to potential risks. For example, Taiwanese locals have to compete for job opportunities with foreigners. For employees at companies that close down, they are laid off. Even high school students like us have to compete against foreign students for college admission.
There is no resisting the wave of globalization. Not a single country, organization, or individual can. In order to help Taiwan, as well as us Taiwanese youth, rise above this wave, the first thing we should do is to evaluate our strengths and weaknesses. From there, we can seek to reach our potential, equip ourselves with the required capacities, and rise to the challenge when the time is ripe.
Our former President Li Zhenhui gave a speech at the 2015 Winter Youth Camp on Taiwan's hopes and the duty of its youth under globalization. In the speech, he urged us Taiwanese youth to fulfill our duties, to pay attention to changes in international circumstances in order to broaden our global perspectives, to explore the challenges and opportunities that Taiwan faces today, and we will overcome and thrive on in the future. To ready ourselves for the task, we have to keep learning with humility, live up to our obligation with determination, stand up for Taiwan with courage, and arouse our people with enthusiasm, especially our young friends. This we must do, my young fellows, to survive and prosper amid this wave of globalization.
Number 3, 计时开始.
Dear honorable judges, I'm going to talk about topic 3. Taiwan has been an important role in Southeast Asia. We need to form nations with Southeast Asia in order to stay competitive in the global community. In the past, Southeast Asia is a crucial player in the trading systems. That was because a wide range of items were only available in the Southeast Asia. Time has gone on, world needs have changed, and we have adapted. The exports from Southeast Asia has shifted from raw materials and other minerals. The focus on industrial materials and electronics is increasing.
For example, although Malaysia and Indonesia is able to produce palm oil, but the growth rate of this is actually dropping. Instead, the growth rate of vehicles and other electronics goods are actually increasing. A country can actually can beneficial from these changes. And we have to be more heavily involved, because the exports from Southeast Asia actually benefit more than if we're involved into the United States of America's imports, and it's increasing still. Many blue-collar workers from Taiwan are actually from Southeast Asia countries. And we have, actually from Southeast Asia countries, we have to actually help them out for a new environment in Taiwan. This isn't only just because of they are foreigners, so we actually should help them out for further needs for them. And a lot of times they got problems between visa requirements or even the lack of being understood. So we have to protect them from further rights damaging.
Globalization is not only westernization. We have to keep remember about this. Because I have relations with a lot of South Asia people, they work for my family or about my friends, and they have take care of about Taiwanese so much, but they have the last time to care about their own. And we cannot have this stereotypes keeping, because they really keep working hard, and there's a lot of time they don't have their free time because we forget about them. We have the race problem actually. So this is not this is really not nice. We have to face about this and make a good attitudes and have a good ways to learn.
I have also found that many of the Southeast Asian people speak English very well. However, it may be hard for them to find teaching position in Taiwan, no matter how educated they are. Therefore, we have to be grateful and be happily using these resources to improve our English fluency. It also came as me for a surprise when I traveled to Vietnam last year and found that their traditions are so similar to us. That was very heartwarming to see that we have so many things in common. In the end of this day, people from Southeast Asia may find their lives hard and miserable. For example, low pay, long working hours, lack of communications, and like being isolated from others. However, Taiwan is doing a great job dealing with these problems. For example, the governments are setting libraries about that have books about Southeast Asian languages and modifying their working environments. And so in conclusion, if we have our mind opened and together work hard and continue to work for a better community, I believe that Taiwan will be an important and powerful country that cannot be ignored in Southeast Asia.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you.
演讲题目是 Number One， 计时开始。
Hello, everyone. In this era of information explosion, the internet has become really common. But the most amazing part is its power. It is definitely beyond imagination. For example, with Pokemon Go, an empty square can be filled up with 2,000 people in less than an hour. With email, two people can be connected, even though there are 200,000 kilometers apart. As you can see, the power of the internet is really unbelievable. Even more incredible is, we can also take advantage of the internet to conduct Taiwan's diplomacy. We can use soft power diplomacy with the internet to increase Taiwan's visibility. Youth are creative, innovative, and good with computers. Undoubtedly then, we youth are the candidates to take on this challenge. Today, we are introducing several platforms that we can use to conduct diplomacy.
Thank you, Christine. There are a lot of resources that youth can use for diplomacy. Take Instagram and YouTube, for example. With these, we can share our photos and films to people around the world. Let's talk about Instagram first. Most users just post mundane details of their daily lives. However, through an app, we can also promote Taiwan by uploading photos of our lovely country so that the world can know our beautiful scenery and culture. Then, how about YouTube? Most of you may think it's just an app to listen to music or watch some videos. If this is what you think, then you are totally wrong. Here are some steps that we can use to conduct diplomacy. First, make films to introduce Taiwan on topics such as geography, economy, culture, and so on. Second, make sure all of your information is correct. For the last step, just upload your short films to YouTube. By doing things that are mentioned above, teens can conduct diplomacy and promote Taiwan in a simple and effective way.
Thanks, Mina. If you are shy and prefer to communicate with others through words, why not try using How Do You Do or email? They are the channels that you can use to meet new friends from all around the world and keep in touch with them. For instance, The app called How Do You Do is a platform to meet new friends online and have a video chat with them. You can have a video chat with someone new and be a youth ambassador of Taiwan. Try sharing some features of Taiwan, like culture, geography, or some scenic beauty of our land. This way, the person will feel your passion and form a great impression of Taiwan, and maybe pay a visit one day. Isn't that just about the best outcome of youth diplomacy? Also, writing email is a great way for us to improve our English writing skills while getting to know a country more at the same time. After you meet someone new on the internet, don't forget to ask for his or her email so that both of you can keep in touch. Next time when you want to share something online, get a pen pal, be enthusiastic, and enjoy your conversations.
Thanks, Vivian. What if you're neither the one who likes to share videos and pictures, nor the one who likes to communicate through writing, and all you like to do is to talk? Then Skype and Messenger are all for you. These two chat apps take advantage of oral talk, letting chatters make direct contact with each other. Besides oral communication, body language is also at play. By speaking with a gesture, it's much easier to express your points of view with others. Take my own experience as an example. I have a lovely American friend, and I always have a talk with her on Skype. At first, Taiwan was just a small island in Asia for her. After my introduction about our culture and customs, she's now looking forward to visiting Taiwan. See, that's definitely a great way to conduct youth diplomacy. Therefore, with Skype and Messenger, we teenagers can contact people from other countries more easily and efficiently. Moreover, both of the chatters are sure to get to know each other's countries, languages, and cultures better. It's not only a way to know other countries well, but also a great way to promote Taiwan.
Thanks, Winnie. Now you know the platforms. These platforms are the most convenient and the easiest tools for youth to integrate themselves into the world. We should make use of the incredible power of these platforms to make new friends, to explore the world, and increase Taiwan's visibility. So what are you waiting for? Open your laptop, pick up your phone, and experience the magic of the cyber world.
Thank you.
Number 1, 计时开始。
YouTube, Facebook, and similar social media are now the dominant forms of media. It is hard to believe that less than a generation ago, these entities did not even exist. New media spread ideas around the world with speeds unimaginable in my parents' generation. Diplomacy is the activity of managing international relations. It is the peaceful transmission of ideas and ideals between countries. We believe the internet is diplomatic by nature. We use the internet and social media to connect to different world regions and cultural backgrounds. We peacefully communicate our ideals with our allies and our foes. We may also accept ideas from others that align with our interests. As young ambassadors, we would like to propose several ideas for conducting youth diplomacy via the internet. More young people than ever are enthusiastically participating in politics. Youth are able to attend diverse political events specifically for young people. Our first plan is join the Model United Nations, MUN. MUN simulates the United Nations. It is a platform for youth to address global concerns and confront a range of international issues via the internet. Participants will develop an appreciation of differing viewpoints and experience the challenges of negotiation. We would like to participate in MUN and share experiences via YouTube, Facebook, and Howcast. We will accomplish this through our school's memberships and leverage its existing international network. Youth from every corner of the world could comment, connect, and learn from this small conference. For example,
If I was acting at the MUN conference as a representative from a country I have never been to, youth from that country could comment whether or not my representation was realistic. Combining social media with Model United Nations would connect participants with their role play. It would connect their role play with the unknown reality.
Educational exchanges are one more method of conducting youth diplomacy. Our next idea is to share videos about our school lives on YouTube with partner schools from other countries. Our videos will include normal curriculum and extracurricular activities. Videos can be short and unedited, or produced and finished as part of multimedia studies. Our channels will be open to commentary and comparisons, and our audience can reciprocate by posting links that share their videos about their school lives. We would also host a TEDx Youth Conference discussing education. With TED Talk's reputation and reach, Taiwanese students could share their opinions and ideas with people from all over the world. Students from other countries can see and hear how we think and feel about a range of themes and issues. This creates an exchange of ideas and ideals between our youth and those from other countries, and puts us into meaningful contact with youth worldwide.
Our last idea is actually about food. Food is one of the most important aspects of Taiwanese culture, and food is also one of the most important aspects of diplomacy. In fact, the idea of culinary diplomacy goes back as far as Greek times. This is such a powerful idea that an American university in Washington, D.C. is even offering courses in culinary diplomacy and conflict cuisines. With fast, easy travel and increasing cultural diversity in most world cities, learning about world cuisines is more popular than ever. Our plan is to create a fan page on Facebook to conduct youth culinary diplomacy. Once we have our fully functional, mobile-friendly website, we would display and discuss our famous Taiwanese food. This would generate buzz from foreign friends and become a focus point for generating friendly discussion. We will show how Taiwanese foods are made and discuss their origins. During live webcasts, we will also interact with people all around the world and exchange ideas about food, eating habits, and how this relates to their respective culture. Promoting Taiwanese food on a fan page on Facebook will help foreigners learn about Taiwanese culture in a fun and interactive way. After all, what better way is there to bring people to a table than with food?
The internet, YouTube, Facebook, and similar social media are by their nature young, global, and inclusive. And these ideals are at the core of diplomacy. Whether we are talking about international issues, school life, or food, new media encourages peaceful and open discussion and respect for different points of view. Thank you for listening to what we think are several very creative ideas for conducting youth diplomacy online.
Number 3, 计时开始。
Southeast Asia consists of various countries, the reach from India to Taiwan, and is generally divided into mainland and island zones. The mainland is actually an extension of the Asian continent. Island or maritime Southeast Asia includes Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, the Philippines. Islam is the state's religion in Malaysia. Virtually all of the Southeast Asia lies between the tropics, and so there are similarities in climates, as well as plant and animal life throughout the region. Temperatures are usually warm, although it is cooler in highland areas. Many products are unique to the region. Therefore, much desired by international traders in early time, for example, several small islands in Indonesia were once the world's only source of cloves, nakmeh, and mace.
The island of maritime Southeast Asia can range from the very large to tiny pinpoints on the map, because the interior of these islands were jungle clad and frequently dissected by highlands. Land travel was never easy. A distinctive feature of Southeast Asia is its cultural diversity. Archaeological evidence dates human habitation of Southeast Asia to around 1 million years ago, but migration into the region has a long history. A remarkable feature of Southeast Asia is the different ways people have adapted to local environments. The immigration popularity of Taiwan has grown during the last decades of the Southeast Asia. Popularity of Taiwan has grown during the last decades of the last 20 centuries. Immigrants contributed substantially, providing labor for the industrialization and electrification of the country.
Young, motivated, and often educated people are go on move, and many of them will come to Taiwan. There are so many positives from our having, such as robust migrant workforce. Job vacancies and skills gaps can be filled. Economy growth can be sustained. Service to an aging population can be maintained when there are insufficient the young locally. Immigrants bring energy and innovations. Host countries are being enriched by the cultural diversity. However, like everything else, excuse me. Having workers willing to work for the low pay, but may allow the employers to work for and lost their productivity, training, and innovations. Depressions of wages may happen, but it seems to be allowed. Migrants can be exploited, and unfortunately, this still happens here.
Increase in population can put pressure on our public services. Unemployment may rise if there are unrestricted numbers of incomers. If integration proves to be a difficult friction for local people, it can cause dire consequences. Large movements of people may lead to more security monitoring, and with that, the ease of movement may facilitate organized crime and people trafficking. The availability of migrant labor seems to have made the difference in some business surviving, or in the case of food processing, not needing to relocate their production abroad. It is clear that immigration can be beneficial for migrants, but only if their rights are protected properly. It can also be beneficial for both countries of origin and the host countries. However, migration also brings social and cultural pressure that needs to be taken into account for future services. When people try to prevent immigration, it just goes underground.
Thank you.
演讲题目是 Number 3, 计时开始。
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Globalization brings a trend of international interaction by building economic, social, and cultural relations. Taiwan's good relations with Southeast Asian countries is also due to the greatly improve our cross-strait relations. Through trade, economic opportunities, youth exchange programs, and social media, countries are able to create and develop good relations with each other. Martina?
Thank you, Stella. The Philippines is one of the Southeast Asian countries which is close with Taiwan in respect to trade and economy. According to Taipei Economic Cultural Office in the Philippines, Taiwan-Philippine bilateral trade volume reached $12 billion in 2013. In 2014, the Philippines is the 8th largest export and the 25th largest import partner to Taiwan. Whereas, Taiwan was the 9th largest export and the 6th largest import partner for the Philippines. The country itself has fair share of high crime rates, drug dealers, and corrupt government officials. Many citizens have fled the country and found refuge in Taiwan. They were able to find jobs that considered good pay by their benefits, and they were also able to support their family back home by salary they receive in Taiwan. However, the Philippines has slowly improved through one person, Rodrigo Duterte, the new president of the Philippines. He has dedicated his life to lowering crime rates and campaigning against drug dealers and corrupt government officials. He is making the Philippines a favorite place for the citizens to live in. Filipinos in Taiwan have made this beautiful island their second home. They married local and embraced Taiwanese culture, and yet still preserving their own culture by opening stores and restaurants that sell Filipino foods and products. This is great for the Taiwanese people because we can experience different culture without leaving our home. Charlie?
Thank you, Martina. Malaysia, another Southeast Asian country, is a place where I had always wanted to visit. I had watched YouTube videos on people's experience living in Malaysia. It gave me a sense of how the country was, so that if I did visit that country one day, I wouldn't have such a huge culture shock. The opportunity came when I went to visit my cousin in Malaysia. I noticed how laid-back people there. They were optimistic and always looked happy and content with their lives. Religion was very important to people there. Most of its citizens are Muslims, so they would pray at least 3 times a day. I had the chance to visit one of the mosques there. It reminded me of the temples that I would go to in Taiwan. I didn't realize how much a role religion had played in both our culture. Another thing I noticed was how much of an influence China had had in Malaysia. There were many Chinese immigrants who had come to work and do some business there. They had set up many companies and had impressive effect on Malaysia's economy. However, when it came to politics, only native Malaysians were allowed to participate. Even if you were immigrants who had gained the citizenship, you still weren't able to be involved in country's politics. I have come to realize Taiwan and Malaysia are not so different after all. We both have strong religious traditions and have been affected by China in one way or another. This may be the reason why we have good relations with each other.
Thank you, Charlie. Taiwan's relation with Southeast Asia must remain strong. With so many threats and wars around the world, we cannot afford to be divided. Through trade, economic opportunities, social media, youth exchange programs, and experiencing and accepting each other's culture, country will have a greater understanding and trust toward one another. We must work together to build a stronger connection.
United we stand, divided we fall.
Thank you.
Number 3, 计时开始.
Good morning.
Taiwan enjoys close economic, social, and cultural relations with countries in Southeast Asia, and is home to many laborers and immigrants from the region.
Currently, there are over 600,000 people from Southeast Asia living in Taiwan. That is about 3% of the population. Some of these expatriates have come here to work or learn. Some have come to settle and make this island their home. And some have come seeking a better life for them and their families. Engaging our Southeast Asian neighbors, learning about their cultures, and sharing their experiences shouldn't just broaden our view of the world. It should also teach us a few things about ourselves. Here's Amber to tell you more.
Thank you, Angel. This April, we had a very special opportunity to receive some honorable guests from Ministry of Education and Culture in Indonesia. We were all very excited to be able to introduce them to Taiwan's culture and also to learn about theirs. Some of the women in the party, but not all, wore hijabs, which are traditional headscarves. And we were eager to ask politely about this custom. We learned from our guest that some Muslim women wear hijabs, but some do not. And it's based on their choice. What's more, different styles of hijabs have different meaning to them. One of our guests says she likes to wear hijabs in dark colors because she thinks it makes her look calm. Now, it's becoming more and more common in Taiwan to see Muslim women wearing hijabs. There are over 125,000 women from Indonesia, as well as thousands of people from Malaysia living in Taiwan. As long as they are here, they have the freedom to express themselves and be who they are without fear. And although some of their customs may be unfamiliar to some of us, we should be understanding and welcoming. For a little more insight, here's Eva.
Thank you, Amber. There are social, political, and economic problems in many Southeast Asian countries, and we should be made aware and understand how fortunate we are. Most Southeast Asians in Taiwan are here for work, and that is what they do. They work hard and long hours to send money home to their families, because Taiwan represents better economic opportunities than they otherwise would have had. There are people who object to this, saying that they take jobs or that they only come here to send money out of the country. But I think we should be more understanding. We here in Taiwan place great value on family, and there are few things as Taiwanese as working hard for the sake of your family. Tony will now bring it all together.
Thank you, Eva. With our government's new southward policy to strengthen economic bonds with Southeast Asian countries, understanding our regional neighbors is becoming more important. Embracing cultural diversity doesn't mean losing touch with who we are. We are a distinct people and should respect the uniqueness of others if we want them to respect it of us. Respect and tolerance are reciprocal. As we move to increase our ties and the movement of people and investment throughout the region, we people of Taiwan need to realize that we are ambassadors of our nation. Our neighbors will judge us by how we treat them
at home and abroad.
Thank you.
Number 4, 计时开始.
Honorable judges, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Today, our topic is humanitarian assistance
forms a key part of developed countries' foreign policy. How should we contribute to international humanitarian assistance endeavors? In recent years, due to global climate change or political instability, humanitarian assistance is becoming a more necessary and required endeavor. In Taiwan, various government agencies and non-governmental organizations, or NGOs, are devoted to encouraging positive changes in the world. Furthermore, humanitarian assistance can not only become a symbol of the amity between two countries, but also demonstrate that the passionate hearts of the people of Taiwan are able to overcome the obstacles of race, age, or culture. The cases that Wilson, Willow, James, and I are going to introduce today are just a few excellent examples of this humanitarian tendency.
Our first example is the Yidian Social Welfare Foundation. This non-governmental organization has become famous worldwide for its selfless spirit. They send volunteers to places in Taiwan that enjoy fewer resources and oversee the provision of other humanitarian efforts as well. They help medical patients and the elderly. They help addicted prisoners to enter drug rehab therapy in Thailand. They take care of victims who are harmed by landmines in Myanmar, and much more. Every summer, they give young Taiwanese people a chance to get involved in this work, hiring teenagers to travel to other nations to help the locals there. This not only allows Taiwan to become a provider of humanitarian effort, but also increases our young people's global perspective while increasing our country's international status.
Another great example is Taiwan's International Health Action, Taiwan IHA Group, which has founded in 2006. It is involved in several international programs and aims to provide humanitarian aid and to promote international sanitation. During severe disasters which have occurred in recent years, like the earthquake which took place in Peru, the hurricane in Myanmar, or the flood in the Philippines, Taiwan has dispatched countless medical groups of youth volunteers in order to assist the residents of those stricken areas. Especially during the serious earthquake which happened in Haiti, Taiwanese medical team successfully rescued more than 2,500 victims in just 2 weeks. Their efforts were rewarded with the sincere thankfulness from Haiti's inhabitants and their government. Taiwan's International Health Action is willing to provide humanitarian aid and to establish collaborative partnerships with foreign hospitals, while further dedicating its contributions to the world and publicizing the love of the people of Taiwan.
Helen Keller once said, "The best and most beautiful things in this world cannot be seen or even heard, but must be felt with the heart. Love is everything. We are all connected by love. Unfortunately, we have no idea why this world keeps breaking our hearts and tearing people apart. However, love glows much brighter in these kinds of dreadful circumstances. Humanitarian assistance represents sincere love from not only our government, but also our citizens. Through the examples we've just mentioned, the Eden Social Welfare Foundations and Taiwan's International Health Action Group, connections, affections, and love are formed. We Taiwanese are very lucky to be in the position to be able to give this love instead of receiving it. We expect that our contributions to humanitarian assistance will continue to deeply touch those in need and successfully achieve our mutual goals of relief and international cooperation." Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for your kind attention.
Number 2, 计时开始.
Our noble judges, fellow competitors, ladies and gentlemen. In ancient Greece, Aristotle once said in politics, man is by nature a social animal. Thus, we have laid great emphasis on collaboration. The same principle is also applied to a country's diplomacy. No country can survive without connecting to the world. Although Taiwan isn't such a big country like the USA, we're closely related to the world socially and economically. Undoubtedly, to strengthen our status quo with other countries, Taiwanese youth are on the front line to take the charge. Luckily, our government and many private sectors have long made efforts to boost our international engagement by encouraging students to participate in different international events with various channels provided.
As high school students, we're still on the path to developing global vision by getting involved in international affairs and exchange with which we build up our global competitiveness simultaneously. To achieve this goal, not our family is capable of affording expense to go abroad. Yet, it's not impossible to broaden our horizons in Taiwan. Taking part in the annual Global Mobility Conference and Youth Policy Forum, conducted by the Youth Development Administration during high school years, are optimal and economical ways. Recently, more and more Taiwanese youth are reluctant to stuck in the rut. Instead, they endeavor to widen their horizons and utilize the knowledge they absorbed. With professional and experienced guidance through the process of brainstorming and group discussion, we will be able to work on controversial international affairs, to develop critical thinking skills, to carry out what we have learned, and to acquire transferable lifelong skills.
Once our minds are well prepared to face the challenges, we may aspire to risk ourselves by having more interaction with native speakers. If that is the case, why not try to be a volunteer in the 29th Summer Universite, held by Taipei City? Unlike the usual overseas studying, it's an access for us to meet people from all over the world. We can grab opportunities to introduce our local delicacies and multicultural to the foreigners and show them our hospitality. Apart from this, Taiwan Peter Pan Project and Volunteering Project, providing Taiwanese students with a springboard to have international engagement without costing an arm and a leg. Through hands-on global volunteering, not only are we forced to put the language skills into practice, we can also know another culture firsthand. Moreover, we can all make contribution to a global community through our youth power.
Although it's hard for us to predict how the world will change, there is one thing we are certain. As other countries put emphasis on the importance of cultivating students with global views, Taiwan should never lag behind. And we Taiwanese youth should take on the responsibilities of making our country stay abreast of the world. In order not to vanish in this competing world, we should equip ourselves with keen attention on current international events and form a habit of participating in a variety of international exchanges. Together, we can make our country a better and powerful one.
Attention, bow.
Thank you for your listening.
各位参赛的同学，或许我应该称呼你们为 honorary speakers。家长，然后领队老师，还有外交部、教育部、公示新民高中的工作团队，以及各位评审的同仁，大家好。我针对今天的很精彩的 英语演说我分成三部分，简单的分享一下我个人的想法，供各位同学还有领队老师参考。第一部分是英语口说能力，那我个人是比较在乎几个细节。第一个部分发音，首先可以请同学考虑一下，就是发音是否清楚，比如说你的重音有没有放在正确的音节。所以发音单字的选择当然是一个最简单最明了判断我们发音英语演说是不是可以让别人听得懂的一个指标。第二个就是句型，比如说你们的英文句型是不是多样化的，还有句子的复杂度长度对于口说的这个形式来讲是不是刚好恰如其分。比如说如果因为句子太复杂太长，也许在口说的形式我们就可能要再三的斟酌。第三个就是说，因为今天的演说是由四位同学合力完成，所以它是一个 teamwork， 所以在比较小的部分就是我会比较着重那个 transition mechanism， 比如说四位的连结是不是刚好有很好的结合在一起，是不是有互相介绍一下说哦上一位讲了什么，所以接下来我们下一位要讲什么，这样的 transition。 第四个是speaking rhythm，比如说有些句子比较长，可能同学在英文演说的时候是不是有在恰当的英文句型的那个 chunks 跟 unit 做一个停顿那个呼吸，然后才可以把这个比较长的句子然后清楚的讲述完整。第五个部分是 style， 就是我发现好像可能如果说不同的成员之间使用的语言有一些会比较 official， 当然是很适合这个场合，可是也许有其他的讲者同一个组员的讲者会 有时候会有突然一两句比较 colloquial 的句子出现，所以四位组员之间的彼此的 style 我觉得也是会提醒一下说可能可以稍微再注意。所以这四点，发音、句型、 transition、speaking rhythm 还有 style， 是在口说能力比较细节的部分我会提醒一下各位同学。那第二个评分的标准就是内容，首先第一个当然就是各位的演说内容是不是切题，然后再来第二点有没有一个明确的主题句，有一个宏观的想法来回应你们所抽到的题目。所以有了一个宏观的句子整体的回应之后，在第二部分我会比较在乎的细节有没有 details evidence， 然后 personal experience 或者是 survey data， 可以让这些你的研究你的演说或者是你的宏观的整体的回应更具有说服力。所以我们有宏观的论述，有微观的细节之后，在第三点当然就是看你的演说的 organization， 比如说是不是每一位讲者都有一个 topic sentence 或者是一串的 topic sentences， 然后有适当的细节微观的部分加以佐证呢。好，所以在内容的部分就是我会注意有没有切题明确的主题的回应，第二个细节，第三个是如何把这两部分结合在一起，就是 organization。 那我评分的第三个部分是台风，就是 stage manner， 其实这部分真的是很不容易，我真的很佩服各位同学们都表现得很好。我会有提醒四点跟大家分享，第一个是肢体语言，你的 body language 是不是自然的，比如说会不会因为紧张啊就只摸你的衣领啊，或者是眼神很飘忽，这些小小的地方。第二个是其实在公众演说有时候忘词或者是你的句子会有一个 false start，你觉得哎，好像第一个字讲错，你稍微要赶快修正，这些都很正常。所以我看一下同学那些即兴的怎么样克服自己一开始讲错句子，或者是说你忘词那时候你要怎么样临场的反应，这个我觉得也很重要。第三个因为演说其实是 communication， 你希望你把你的想法讲给观众听，所以其实你是在跟观众讲话，不是背稿。所以当然我相信大家都 rehearse 很多次，可是是不是 rehearse 过头的时候会稍微比较僵硬，还是说同学们可以在僵硬跟对稿子很熟练跟自然度之间做一个很好的拿捏，这个我觉得大家也都做得蛮不错的。那第四个部分就是说，我觉得语言说还是要有一些情绪的部分，因为其实很多研究指出，我们请听众来反映一下说你刚刚听到的内容是什么，然后大部分的观众的陈述的结果就是说他们大概记得二成到三成对方讲的内容，可是更多时候七成到八成大家是记得对方讲话的方式，还有讲者带给你听众什么样的感觉。所以那个说话者的情绪还有你的 body language， 你整体而言看起来是自信的还是紧张的， 其实都会那个，你怎么样带你带给观众什么样的感觉，其实都是很重要的。好，所以我今天的就是评分，我个人是按照这三大类，然后分别有不同的细项在进行。其实我觉得今天各位参赛者都对自己的英语实践做出了很好的那个表现，那我相信也为你们学校的学弟妹做出一个很好的示范。那我也预祝我们今天的得胜的队伍可以在12月的决赛旗开得胜，马到成功。好，谢谢。
Good afternoon. Wow, this is very scary to stay here. How did you do that? To begin with, I'd like to thank Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Education, and Shinmin High School for organizing this. Believe it or not, I know you have worked very hard, but behind the scene, there are also a lot of people who work very hard to make this happen. I'd like to thank the judges, and most importantly, I want to thank the participants for participating. So please give yourself a big hand. Also, I'd like you to appreciate, I know that behind the scene here, also there were a lot of teachers who helped you organize all these things for you and make this happen. Also, please give your teachers a big hand. It takes a lot of courage and hard work to do what you did today and yesterday. So this is not by all means anything easy and anything light to be taken lightly. So you should know that the courage that you took to stand here and perform the way you performed is the most important element of this participation, the confidence that you gave yourself. Whether or not you are happy with what you did, or whether or not we are happy with what you did, it doesn't matter. What matters is that you took the courage among, I don't know, 2,000, 1,000, how many students in your school, you, four of you, were the ones who took the courage to come here. That's what is really important. So do not take our grading literally. This is just because we have to do some grading and because we need to know who's the first and who's the second. I am the last one to comment, so I have prepared a very short list. Oh, only 5 minutes. Okay, so let me just give you a couple of things I want to tell you. First of all, I'm pretty sure you're familiar with the word KISS. Not that kind of KISS. K-I-S-S, keep it short and simple. It is very difficult to deliver a topic of your given topic in 5 minutes. So your job is always to deliver the main point and in a short time and very simply. Do not try to put in so many things in one presentation. And that is easier for you and easier for people to follow. Another thing is that both in today and yesterday, we have English, grading for English, and content, which is the most important part, most important grade. Now, if you realize that the content, to understand your content, we also need to have a English. So the English and the content are really closely related to each other. In the topic of English, again, I'm just reviewing what the other judges have said and what your teachers have always told you. We have two things in English. One is your pronunciation, and the other one is your enunciation or articulation. Pronunciation is something that is gained throughout the years. But you can really work on your enunciation. And enunciation, if your enunciation is clear and good, people will forgive your pronunciation because they can understand you. So I'm pretty sure you have known about this thing. I'm just, because I have to say something here. So I am telling you this thing just as a review. And another thing is that when you stand in here, the first thing is always a greeting. So no matter what, we need to be kind to our audience. And then you give an introduction about yourself. Of course, you are not allowed to make an introduction about your school, so that part we can skip. Then you introduce your topic. And you can state the purpose of that topic so that in the first part of your presentation, maybe the first 30 seconds, when I listen to you or when people listen to you, they know that you are kind, they know that what your topic, and also they know what are you going to do. What is one sentence, one purpose that your presentation will give? And finally, I want to talk about the first, because you're working on a group, so the first impression is very important. First impression for us comes from where? Comes from, first of all, looking at your topics, writing of your topics. Here we are all English teachers, except for me, I'm not a very good one, but we have English teachers. So the first thing is to look at your topic. I looked at the topics yesterday and there are some I really didn't understand. That's why I was trying to look, surf the internet, see if there is some new words maybe I don't know in English. And some of them have punctuation problem and so on. That is the first impression I get from that group, the choice of topic and how you write it. And then when you come in the stage, the first thing that you say is leave the first impression. The last person gives the audience a lasting impression. So choose the best people to be the first one and the last one in your speech. Again, I'm pretty sure your teachers have already said that. And so your choice of topic is very important. It's important because people will, before you stand in here, people will judge you based on the topic you have chosen. What does it mean? Does it make sense or does it not make sense? And that's the very first impression we get from your group. In short, I have to again tell you that we just have some opinions, and these opinions are based on these five people who are sitting here. You bring another five people, maybe have different opinions. So do not worry about what happens after this, but be proud of yourself and be proud of your courage and the hard work that you did. And I wish you all best in the future. Thank you very much.
各位同学、各位师长，还有各位工作伙伴，大家好，辛苦了。哎，首先给自己一个掌声好吗？你们都表现很好，刚才经过评审激烈的讨论，然后刚才评审也有跟各位做讲解，相信各位同学也会学习很多，对未来要参加各项比赛或是学习成长都有很大的帮助。那等一下我们会先来宣布那个十名的优胜队伍。十名的优胜队伍，二号新竹市私立曙光女子高级中学，威格高级中学；十一号台中市私立宏文高中；十七号东海大学附属实验高级中学；十八号国立彰化高级中学。二十一号台中市中明高级中学，二十三号云林县私立振兴高级中学，第二十六号新竹市私立磐石高级中学，第二十八号苗栗县私立建台高级中学，第三十五号台中市明德高级中学。恭喜这十所队伍哈！
那接下来我们继续有请陈秋香专门委员为我们不分名次揭晓105年外交小尖兵英语种子队选拔活动中区初赛的六名入围决赛的队伍。
三号彰化市立金城高级中学，九号台中市华盛顿高级中学。十三号台中市私立明道高级中学， 14号台中市私立小明女子高级中学。29号台中市私立新民高级中学。好，31号台中市私立惠文高级中学。恭喜这六所队伍要到台北参加决赛，希望你们在去台北的时候能够旗开得胜，能够进入前三名代表队伍，然后到国外去参访，恭喜各位，恭喜。